Oh. Oh no. Come on, dice. Don't start doing this now.
Shante.
Shante. I like it.
And if you're already back, you have to say so. The camera's on your dice box.
I'm back. Sorry, I'm just eating. I forget these things, okay? I'm just sitting over here munching on chips, so I'm here.
Okay. So the abbot with Mushi are singing up on a bit of a small step up in this relatively once humbled looking temple, as it has since suffered some severe fire damage. Portions of walls are missing, as well as the roof beams seem to have visible holes leading up into open sky. But he gestures towards Grubender to place Cognar on the altar before him.
So I'm putting Cognar on the altar.
All right. So the abbot kind of walks around Cognar once, his hand kind of trailing about Cognar as he does so. And he stops once again where he started his circle. He places his second hand onto Cognar. He closes his eyes deeply. He begins a small prayer, looking up into the sky, his eyes closed. Begins asking the beloved great goddess, the great mother, to seed life into this since deceased seedling so that he might sprout and spread goodness with her blessing. And as he continues on this prayer, he removes one hand from Cognar and reaches into his robes and pulls out a small pouch. And he rests it atop Cognar's chest, and places his hand back onto Cognar, and he begins a chant of sorts. It's fairly inaudible, and the few words you can make out don't seem to make much sense. But after a moment or two, Cognar's body does slowly lift up from the altar. And a beaming green light emanates from inside of the pouch on Cognar's chest. And after a moment or two, Cognar slowly drifts back down onto the altar. And the green light from the pouch slowly fades. And Cognar takes a deep breath of air. He's once again at one hit point.
I'm sorry, that couldn't have been better timing for that.
That's all the air you've been holding in.
What's going on? I thought we were on a boat.
Well, we've had some adventures since then.
Things happen.
I drank that much.
Apparently.
Yes, yes, you did. It knocked the wind out of you. Glad to see you're back on your feet.
For a couple of days.
Must have been one hell of a party.
You'll never remember.
Apparently not. Where are we? What am I doing here?
I guess I'm Cognar.
You're in hell.
I see you, she looking down at me. Oh, God.
We've traveled a little. Ooh. And now we are in Golden area.
Golden Fields. The Abbot's
Golden Fields. Golden Fields.
Golden Fields.
And Commander looks to the Abbot, says, "Thank you so much. I don't know what we can do to repay you for this. But if there are others that need healing, I still have some powers left in me. Please point me to them, and I will do what I can for them."
And he kind of holds his arm and he raises one hand up and says, "Please, you have done more than enough for us already. I would not ask for you to repay me for this, as I was simply doing what the grain goddess has put me here for, to sow her seeds, to see through life so that others may continue. By continuing with good in your hearts, you is more than enough to have repaid me. Should you so choose to remain and help whatever means you can, it would be greatly appreciated. But please know that it is by no means necessary. We will make do, and we will attempt to slowly start rebuilding, replanting, regrowing, as is the cycle of life."
"Again, we thank you, and I understand, but I have been called to help those in need, to stand up for those who have been oppressed. And while I believe that the greatest help we can be for you and for the people of this area is not to stay here and help you rebuild, but to search out those who have done this, at least for now, I also wish to fulfill my calling and help those who have been injured by the evil in this world."
And he slowly starts nodding along as you are talking. He says, "Indeed, to prevent further catastrophes of this nature."
"Yes. And there is much I wish to discuss with you. You know this area far better than I do, and I feel that you deserve to know why we have been brought here and what it is that we face. You may be able to give us further insight into what is happening."
He says, "I will gladly answer any questions that I am able. But if it's about those 7 men who came here, I'm afraid I cannot answer much specifics."
"Obviously, we wish to know all that we can know about them. But there are other things that you may not be aware of. Or you may have heard whispers that could help us as we seek to stem the evil that is rising here." And without actually saying all of it, I'm going to explain to him, you know, kind of about the cults, you know, the fact that we've seen what we believe to be the earth cultists, the air cultists, the water cultists, and potentially some fire cultists. And you know, kind of tell him what we've seen and where we've seen it, and see if he knows anything about any of those sorts of happenings. And as long as I'm at it, you know, if I see anyone who needs healing, I'm going to go around and heal them, because I have two more of these, so I'm spending them all.
All right. So several members kind of come towards Grabender as he's offering these healings. He begins healing some of their badly wounded limbs and the like. As this conversation with Abbott, Ellard, and Daravik continues. And during the series of these stories that Grabender is telling, the Abbott's face goes from surprise to shock to all over the board, appropriately, the story. As he's paying careful attention to the words you're telling him, and he's kind of waiting for his own time to speak. Like, he's letting you have all the time you need to get this off your chest.
And as Bender's kept it in so long.
As you begin kind of wrapping up, he slowly nods his head, says, "There have been whispers of various cult activities in the lands from some of the travelers we've had through here. There was talk of a series of stone-faced men near Westbridge. There, however, has not been much coming from the Emerald Enclave in response to these whispered rumors. Perhaps you're looking for more armed support. You may seek out the knights at Summit Hall. As the Knights of Samular are, much like yourself, here to protect these lands. As far as the cultists you speak of, I'm afraid we had no encounters or knowledge of them specifically until all of this happened.
Where did you say the stone-faced men had been seen?
Westbridge.
And the knights of the what hole?
Knights? Samular.
Oh my gosh, they do not like that.
Summit Hall.
I had a question. My dogs totally made me forget it. Damn them. Okay. These travelers, when they came through your town, did they happen to say anything as to where they were headed? Or perhaps what their plans were? Anything at all to give you an idea as to where they might be now?
You mean the adventurers who made their way through here, or the men who did this?
They are not the same?
I'm afraid not. The adventurers we tend to get through here often come in times of peace to help tend the fields themselves, simply just walking through to resupply themselves with food for the next 10 days or so. We have travelers of all sorts, and so when the 7 men came to our doors, we took no particular notice of them, as it was completely ordinary for strangers to come to our doors and be welcomed among us.
So there was nothing notable of them. They were all just average beings.
There were six men seemed to wear a set of armor that was fairly uniform. Their dark goggles covered their eyes, and the lone individual wore robes, brown hair, short beard. I'm sorry, there's nothing more that I can give you. But as I said, we had no reason to take particular note of these seven when they arrived.
I understand. It was not your fault. This was far out of your hands.
Emmett, I hate to ask this, but as we have told you, we were fighting against the air cultists and were eventually overcome and stripped of our belongings and our weapons. We do not wish to take any of the food or things that you need to help those here, but do you perhaps have some spare armor or weapons of any kind, so that we may be better able to face the foes who are in front of us?
He softly begins shaking his head and says, I'm afraid we do not carry arms of any sort in the town, the entirety of Golden Fields. We choose not to arm ourselves so that any travelers feel significantly more comfortable. We refrain from taking sides in most matters, and our neutrality results in us helping all sides, any wanderers who makes their way to us. By remaining neutral, we refrain from taking up arms against anyone. And so we are unarmed. I'm sorry. I wish there was something more we could provide to you, but we have little more than what remains of our food supplies, which you are more than welcome to help yourselves to. We could provide food for a 10-day for at least three of you.
No, there is no need for that. I am able to call upon the blessings of Bahamut in my time of need to provide for our food needs.
Bows his head, and he goes for a bit of parchment inside of his own robe and scribbles something out on it fairly quick. And he passes it over to the vendor. And he says, if it's any consolation, you should be able to bring this to any smith within the nearby valley, and they should be able to provide you with at least mundane arms.
That is most gratefully accepted.
And he kind of makes a gesture to some of the other priests and robed individuals whose limbs you have healed up, and he says, it's, as I said, the very least I can do for what you've already done for us.
I'm just going to kind of bow to him and say, I believe that unless there's something we can help you with, that we must once again, look to the road to discover more about how to defeat these foes.
and I do understand. If it is time for you to depart, then it is the will of the Grain Goddess that the wind will travel you in a different direction from our own.
We will send word once we have cleansed this land. You should be able to plow your fields again in peace.
I look forward to hearing it.
I'm going to kind of look around everybody and kind of motion like we should probably head out.
And I will go up to this bald-headed man. I'm so scrolled out, I can't read his name.
Abbott. Elardin Darovic.
Darovic. Mr. Yeah. Abbottman.
Abbottman.
And I will put out my hand to shake his and say thank you again for everything you've done, and I only hope we will once again find peace in this land.
As he goes for your hand, he kind of clasps it with both of his own, bows his head, and says a small prayer.
And she will bow her head until he finishes.
I hop off whatever I'm laying on.
And please be safe in your travels.
Someone farted.
Not me. You talking about your dog?
Yeah.
Oh, gosh.
One of my dogs. And it smells like death in here now.
Yabbit is very taken aback at this state.
It's bad.
Cognar is going to hop off whatever he's laying on and look at the newcomers to the group and say, who are these folks?
Yes, Cognar, let me introduce you. This noble warrior is Leith.
She will bow her gigantic head.
I will just nod at you, I guess.
And our gnome friend here goes by the name Dangle.
Hello, my name is Dangle.
Hello, Dangle. It is a pleasure to meet you.
God, I'm talking to myself. This is so freaking crazy.
Like I said, playing to you is weird.
At least you guys have accents, so I'll get there.
You know how hard it is to drop in and out of accent for two different characters? And that's not very easy.
I can't even do it for one.
So. We're not voice actors. Anyway, these are two of the three who helped us to escape. They boarded the ship which we were being transported upon and routed the slavers who were piloting it.
Well, that's fantastic.
And I'll run over and I'll just grab Dangle in a big old hug.
Now you're hugging yourself.
I know, it's weird.
And I'm now going to be actually making my way towards the door to try to leave.
All right.
I'll put Dangle down and I'll walk out with Grabender.
And Leaf will follow with Miyushi in the rear.
All right, so the party leaves what remains of the small temple. And Cognar is greeted by this landscape of charred, worked fields, as far as I can see.
Cognar, what's wrong?
There's death everywhere.
I yes. Death. The, just a new life beginning.
There was a great fire here.
It's not still burning, is it?
Do you see any flames anywhere?
I don't know. I've apparently been passed out.
cast out is not exactly the word I would use.
Right. As long as there's no active flames, I think I'll be all right.
Let us return to the ship.
Yes.
We must discuss what our next goal is.
As we're walking, I'm going to kind of whisper to Grender,
Do we have any kind of weapons?
Not really. We were quite thoroughly looted when we were taken captive in the Air Cult cave.
Hmm.
However, they never did take my Bat Guano, so I can still electrocute you.
Bat Guano? Well, that's nice. But
it is quite exciting.
I need a blade if I'm to defend myself of some sort.
I believe if we can make our way to a nearby town, we shall be able to acquire weapons.
I do have a hammer.
Gave me a... What exactly did he give me?
A small parchment of paper, kind of quickly scribbled out, that kind of essentially lays out who you guys are and that you are coming on behalf of the Abbot and to provide you with the means necessary to defend yourselves.
Okay. So it is unlikely that we will find the quality of items which we already possessed, but we will at least be able to acquire the items that will make us effective again.
Well, that's all I can ask for. Oh no. The master's gonna be pissed at me. I lost my hammer.
I have every intention of reacquiring our items.
Well, that's good.
As do I. I am not happy.
Well, I say we get rearmed and take back what is ours.
I agree.
To the ship.
To...
Ahoy, mateys.
To the ship that... I passed out in. Why Correct. Are we heading back there?
Well, we sort of own it now.
Oh, well. That's nice.
Do you fear water as much as you fear fire?
I prefer it.
Hmm. Well, maybe that will change. And she will walk by.
As she walks by, I'm going to whisper to Gabender out of her earshot,
What's up with her?
I don't know entirely. She's been acting a little strange lately.
I mean, I know I drank a lot, but I must have knocked my head really hard when the boat sloshed.
About that, Well, you actually kind of died.
Really?
Yes. That's why you don't remember anything.
Well, I will say that it's not as painful as one time in my life. Huh. I thought death would hurt more.
Well, at least now you know.
Yeah.
But let's try not to do it again.
Yeah. I agree. I could use a nap, though. But still awake.
Couldn't we all?
Well, let's go back to the ship of yours and... I guess
Ours.
Get out of here.
Our ship.
Our ship. Anyway, the ship.
So meanwhile, Ryleth has spent this time being completely invisible in some of the shadows nearby the ship.
Did I see anything?
He sees several more of the priests kind of picking about the charred remains of the fields. But nothing really noteworthy aside from that.
Okay. And he's going to stay hidden until the guys get there.
After some time, he does see the familiar faces of the two new guys, as well as the three slaves that they rescued. One of them up and walking this time. The first time.
Ah. Yep, still invisible.
All right, so the rest of the party all finds their way back to the ship. It seems to have been tied off loosely in some thing, as whatever the ship was once tied to is no longer visible, as a rope kind of loosely dangles.
Hey, that's the kind of stuff I was watching for.
What? Right, like the ship's not moving. The ship's just like not tied off.
Oh god.
Like the ship has been shored, but it's
okay.
Like, it's not.
And Leith is going to scratch her head, very confused. I left the log right here. I know I did.
And
I know it didn't just grow legs and walk away.
I'm going to
right here.
Walk up behind Leith and say, yeah, the log kind of disintegrated on us.
I don't know what you said, but I left it right here.
And he just walks away.
I was distracted with what
Sorry.
Lucas was saying,
Sorry.
And Family I forgot Max. Where I was going with it. So I just went with it.
The dog is begging for water. I'll be right back.
Don't dehydrate your dog. That's bad.
Jeez.
Animal abuse. It's all PETA.
I don't know if Mushi really needs one of those, but I mean, I'll take it. Why not?
Well, Dangle just basically took the swords off the other people and gave it to you guys and then went back out to deal with the water elemental, so you guys do have them.
Okay. Sounds good. I mean, I got it now.
And since I don't really feel like RPing with myself, Cognard's going to have a conversation with Dangle and seeing if he's got weapons, and he's going to give Cognar a scimitar. And so that's last of the scimitars.
All right. So as Cognar makes his way aboard the ship, he steps over three visibly slain and deceased bodies, kind of in the middle of the ship.
Oh, I forgot they were still on there.
Oh. Looks like someone had some fun without me.
It was quite an enjoyable time. And I'm very sarcastic when I say that.
Which one is sarcastic in saying that?
Mushi.
Okay.
She was under freaking. Yeah. And then
were you Leith even involved in that battle? Like out of character?
Nope, that's why she rolled her eyes and was very sarcastic.
Ah.
And Leith will come up and say God, I don't know. Too bad you missed it. Maybe next time. Yeah. And she will walk past him onto the ship.
Well,
damn.
friendly bunch we have here. Can't see what, can't wait to see what kind of messes we get into.
Well, if we're good enough, maybe we won't get into any messes. Honestly, we're quickly.
This is also true, but does anyone have any ale? I could use a drink after this sloshing around and waking up in a temple.
And Leith will let out a laugh. And funny you should mention that orange-haired little thing. For we found your body lying across huge cask of ale, right inside the cabin. It's as though it was calling to you, even in death.
What? Well. Shall we drink to my death then, mighty warrior?
Well, if not that, then we will find another reason to drink.
I like the way you think.
And Cognar's gonna break open the cask and start drinking.
And Leith will join, and Mushi will have a cheer for your death, and then she will stop.
Hey, I died! This is fantastic!
Are there any symbols on these barrels inside the cap of the...
Oh, God. Did Cognar just there drink nitroglycerin that the fire guys are going to blow me up with?
The only markings are kind of to indicate what they are.
Okay. Nice. I was making sure it wasn't like dwarven ale again, that the stone people ale again, you know?
Oh, yeah. Mm. Don't drink the Kool-Aid.
Oh, I do.
Oh, I do. It might give you a buff.
It's delicious. All right, so one by one, the party members make their way back to the ship.
Did we get a chance before I died to know what belongings we had with us? Or no, because we were tied up the whole time. Never mind.
Right.
I was going to say, I'd like to know if I'm missing half my stuff because a goblin took it. But I don't.
Do you know it's a goblin yet?
No, that's why I don't know if
he took it. Cognar definitely notices his lack of items, but he doesn't know...
Which items are lacking?
He doesn't know that they were taken by the goblin.
Okay, that's good to know. It's hard to RP myself. It's all in my head.
So what was decided while I was getting water for the dog?
We just walked back to the boat, and Leith and Cognar had a conversation about me dying and us drinking to it.
They cracked open the cask of dwarven
piss water.
Nope, just a cask of ale.
Oh, it's not even dwarven piss water. That's great.
Just regular piss water.
Just regular piss water. I love it. Some of that Tijuana stuff.
They actually mistook it with the bucket that everyone's been using on the ship.
That's not right. Good. As long as he gets a high off of it. Or a low. So whatever you
feel. From the Golden Fields, do we know where like the nearest village or anything is?
I would say the three newbies know that it's probably Womford.
Okay. And do we have any idea when we're supposed to be back at the Feathergale Spire or the Scarlet Moon Hall, whichever one it was?
We lost track of days.
So as far as the Feathergale Spire, you don't have any kind of a time limit or anything, but you...
Oh.
Roll me a history check for Bender.
Cool. All right. It's advantage or no?
Just a straight.
Okay, history.
Actually, with advantage, because the rest of the party is assisting you.
Yeah, I remember how long we were underground. I'm a dwarf.
Look at that, a 17 and a 15. So that means that for history, I rolled a 16 and a 14.
So Mishi keeps yammering on about this time limit that she has before she has to be somewhere, but Rebender distinctly remembers that they weren't given a time limit in order to return to Feathergale Spire, but they were asked to shoot up a symbol into the air using the spell scroll that they were given.
Ah, I forgot about that. Yeah, they can come pick up.
Grabender, remember.
And Grabender doesn't know anything about, like, the secret chat she had with the guy.
I'm waiting, like, 6 months for this 10 days.
Glad. You need to learn how to count real-world time first.
Yeah. No. It's been at least 6 years.
So the party members...
week.
Yep.
And we're probably already past that, but okay.
No, don't you dare say that. Don't. I have been waiting like 6 months for this 10 day.
Glad. You need to learn how to count real world time first.
Yeah. No. It's been at least 6 years.
So the party members climb aboard the ship once more. Still faced in its southward direction. And
if we are going to sail north, we're going to figure out how to use the actual sails, because the river's flowing south.
We have been very lucky thus far. Now it's down to our wits. Bahamut, save us all.
Amen. And Ryleth is going to pipe up with, there is a southern fork to the river that runs somewhat to the south and east of Womford. Perhaps we could take the boat there and walk to Womford.
As Ryleth's suggestions met with complete silence. Five other people in the world.
I take that to mean you all agree. Excellent. Let us attempt to sail there.
Do you know how to use sails by any chance? From Miyushi. I like to put my different colored dye on here for who I'm talking. Red will be Miyushi, blue will be Lee.
Well, no. But we can try.
Leith will excitedly reply, I am up for anything. Let's sail this ship. We've done it once before, and we can do it again.
So, Ryleth is going to try to figure out which way the wind is actually blowing right now.
Alright. So the wind does appear to be blowing in a direction that would be favorable to sail northward.
But the wind is blowing in the right direction. Now is probably the best time to try.
Lead the way. But I will be, like, grab on to two, or Leith will grab on to, like, two different ropes. And, like, just look at him waiting for direction. Having no idea what to do with these ropes. But she is holding them ready.
Ryleth is going to make his way to the tiller. Or the steering wheel, and he's going to say, Leith and Grabender, perhaps you should help push us out into the current again.
Look at that, we're in the current. No. And Leith will drop the ropes she was holding and get off the boat.
Same for Grabender.
All right.
And she will go behind and push again.
That pushing thing again.
All right. Strength check with advantage.
23. Do I need that?
Yeah, 21.
Oh, I do get advantage. 19.
So, repeating relatively the same motions as the last time, it successfully worked for them. They managed to push the boat off the shoreline, once again still facing the south or southernmost direction. So basically the map, but opposite.
Right. And so Ryleth is going to start steering into the current, make a slow sweeping turn, trying to go to the north and try to get the sails to catch the wind.
Right. Can you roll me an athletics check for Ryleth? To steer the ship against the wind.
Okay.
As I'm assuming Leith and Greben are both flying back on board.
Yes. I wasn't sure if we had to do another like athletics or acrobatics check, so I just wanted to make sure.
I'm going to give it to you guys this time.
Ah, you're so good.
That would be an 11.
11. So Ryleth, taking the wheel, begins shoving all of his weight into the wheel, and it's taking all of his strength to force this ship to turn about against the current. But he manages to bring the ship around. And with that, the ship is pointed in the north direction.
All right. And I'm just going to keep pointing it north and be on the lookout for that other like river branching that I know is up to the north of us.
All right. So after a couple more hours of sailing, So after 30 minutes or so, you can clearly see a fork in the river. The wide stream continuing to the north and a narrower stream continuing to kind of the northeast.
I'm going to steer for the northeast branch.
Dope. And for the sake of map-wise, whereabouts is he aiming to land the ship? Just
anywhere in this general vicinity.
All right. So it takes some time, and the crew's kind of running about, tending to different ropes and the like, trying to figure out these sails. And after a couple of hours, they think that they've kind of got it down to a science. Loose science, but a science nonetheless.
Perhaps a weird science?
And is he just kind of steering it towards the shore? To land it, or...
Yeah, once again, okay. Just kind of okay. Wanting to beach it.
During this whole trip, we've had a few hours, yes?
Yeah.
You're just going to pull Grabender aside in a very hushed tone. She is going to sound very concerned and say, Grabender, my good friend, there's some grave news I'm holding on to, and I fear the worst. These lands down there that we have recently left, I can't help but feel they had something to do with while we were in the dungeon. During my dream, I was in front of a map, and I was holding a dagger. And although I had no control over it, the dagger slammed down onto the southern part of the map. And I know now, for sure, that is where the dagger slammed down. And I awoke with these burns all over my hand and all over the dungeon. And I fear all over Golden Fields as well. I don't know what it means yet. I know we need to figure this out. And I ask your help.
I'd like to insight check Nushi.
All right.
Let's see how it is.
That would be an 18.
All right. So, one second. Nushi, go ahead and roll me a d20.
Oh, four.
All right.
You win.
So, Mushi, what does he detect from you?
As far as Gabriel,
you can whisper it to me.
Like, there's clearly more to the story than what Mushi is giving off.
Clearly.
And you can type it to me and whisper.
I can do that. We don't want Lucas to know our shenanigans.
Exactly.
Then also whisper that to the DM. So the DM.
Well, you get to see all the whispers, don't you?
No. I thought he did, but he
can't. Not between people.
Oh, see, I really thought you could.
Nope.
Well. And before this gets started, I'm going to... I guess I'd forgotten that Dangle gave me a scimitar. So I'm going to pass that on to Cognar, because I'm not proficient in martial weapons.
All right.
I don't really know how to use a scimitar. And while Mushi's telling me all the things that I insight about her, I'm going to tell her, you say you dreamed something about golden fields, and you're afraid that it's come true. Did you? Are you saying you had a vision?
I cannot say what it is exactly. There have been several dreams that have been coming to me. I've told you of the one that left the mark on my hand, of the dagger. This is why I seek to go to the Scarlet Moon Hall so badly. There is much I need to know, and little I do know. And then, after meeting the man who has killed our dearly departed Cassie, I had another one. And I was in a temple area, I can only assume. I was surrounded by, what are they called? I want to say portraits, but that's not the right word.
Tapestries?
Tapestries. And in front of me there was a table. And I heard whispers all around me. And they said, that the prophecy must come true, that it was happening and I mustn't stand in the way, or I can't remember exactly what they were saying, but it was very frightening and it terrified me. And before I knew it, my hand was grasping this dagger I've dreamt before about, and it slammed down into the map. And originally I couldn't be sure as to where this was stabbing into, but now I know it was Golden Fields. And when I awoke, my hand was burned and charred and healed over already. But I know deep down, this is what happened from that dream.
Well, that is disturbing, but it's also strange. I also have been having dreams lately that seem much more than dreams. You appeared in them. I was faced with many choices about my path and how I serve Bahamut. But I believe my dreams have given me clarity, where yours seem only to have caused you pain. I will think upon this, and I will pray upon it.
I fear this is not the only time I have had dreams. When I was very young, when my family died, I was called away on dreams as well. though it was a long time ago. I'm not entirely sure as to what they were. When I awoke, my family was dead, and my house was burned down. I know nothing good will come of this, and I only hope we will find a solution to this never-ending problem. And one day, I will be able to harness these powers and truly be able to help people instead of destroy them.
You have helped many already. We fight for good. And I do not believe that you have caused any of what is happening. I hope that these dreams, these visions, are something that can help us. Something that will guide us to where we need to go. And I want you to have this. And I reach into what's left of my stuff. And I pull out a little charm. It's not really a dream catcher. It has a vague look like that. It's kind of made out of twine and some like little stones. And I'm going to give that to Yushi and say, I acquired this in my travels. It is known as a popular remedy for worry. It is supposed to prevent the thoughts that come along with exposure to evil. I do not believe that I need this, but you may. Keep it with you. And when you worry that things are not going well, look at it.
Thank you, my good friend. I will cherish this. And I only hope it brings peace. Now let us rearm ourselves. And hopefully we will find answers instead of more questions.
Indeed. And get back to the group.
All right. In the meantime, go ahead.
Oh yeah, in the meantime, Ryleth has been trying to find in this general vicinity somewhere that is capable of kind of camouflaging the boat. He's going to steer towards that.
Roll me a survival check with disadvantage.
Okay, survival, disadvantage. Come on, lucky dice. Ow! Really? It's a 6.
Alright. So, as he's kind of scouring the shoreline, he believes he's found somewhere. There's a bit of brush kind of popping up near the shoreline, and some of the trees a little more abundant there. It looks to be like a tight squeeze for the ship, but he thinks it could make it.
He's steering towards it then.
All right.
I'm going to tell everyone, I think it would be best if we tried to hide the boat here. There seem to be enough trees and bushes to obscure it, and we will cover it with branches before we leave. Perhaps no one will discover it.
I only hope trees will be able to hide a ship as large as ours in a river. That doesn't sound very comforting.
That'll just be the best we can do.
So Ryla steers the ship towards the shore, aiming carefully for this kind of narrow opening that he got in order to hide the ship. And as the ship's nearing this opening, an audible snap can be heard as one of the wooden beams used to repair the ship snaps. The ship turns ever so slightly, and rather than going for the narrow opening Riley saw, the ship tends to shore itself in a relatively open area outside of the brush, but still on the riverbank.
Oh, man. What did you roll?
A 2.
And I'll say that was rolls on my side for the ship. Rolls on his side for the... The opening wasn't going to be big enough for the ship.
Yeah.
But the ship was going to break.
Grinder is going to go down and try to figure out where the snapping came from.
Alright, so as Grinder kind of looks through a gap in what is kind of still a visible hole, he can see that some of the wooden beams that were used to kind of jerry-rig the ship together for the passage to Golden Fields have started to kind of give way, and they're slowly bending under the weight of the whole ship. So it looks like it's going to need some repairs.
Yeah. Not a shock.
Surprise, surprise!
Okay. Well, it looks like some of our repairs are starting to fall apart. I think we will have to get appropriate supplies before we can sail her again.
Oh, to get a broken heart.
Oh, poor ship. We'll put you
back
together.
That's wrong. The ship has a broken heart.
Well, either way, we need to get to a town to rearm.
Well, we should be relatively close to Womford. We can probably make our way there in just a few hours.
What time is it?
It's about in the afternoon. About maybe 4 in the afternoon.
I say we walk until nightfall, rest, and then come in the morning.
Also, I will say real quick, Cognar can't choose to spend any number of hit dice that he wants because you guys were on the ship for a couple of hours. Yeah, short rest. Right.
Well, he will do that. D12s. Oh, I don't have... Ooh, what's my favorite D12?
Dun-dun-dun!
Alright, so well, I'm going to use that one, and that one,
and... Achoo, Pikachu!
Alright, I'm going to use...
Oh, please let it be on!
Excuse me, Achoo, you Trinkachoo!
Good roll! 19, 24.
And plus 12 for your constitution.
Oh, yes, that's right. Oh, 36. Sweet. Up to 47.
Right. And when he mentions walking until nightfall, I don't believe it will take us until nightfall to reach Womford. If we leave now, we should be able to get there just about sunset. It's possible we could even find lodging at the inn.
I don't know about you, Gabenga, but I have no gold.
I was trying to make the voices different enough. That was actually Ryleth.
I don't know.
Ryleth is a really deep voice.
I can't believe they took our gold.
Monsters.
I don't know about you, but I don't have any gold. I'll just leave out the name.
And Grabender's going to pipe up and say, I do not have much, but I do have probably enough for us to to purchase a night at the inn.
And Leith will cut in. Yes, I believe we will be able to stay a nice night if we so choose. Let us get moving. There is no reason to dilly-dally. For I'm not much of a sitter.
Yeah, by the way, for the newbies, I never actually put in any gold or anything. Do we have gold?
Do you have what's in the gold slots up top on your inventory for the kind of group loot? Because I know you were doing that kind of in an Excel document. Mm-hmm. So I didn't have access to those numbers, mm-hmm. but for the time being, that is gone.
The newbies, did we decide that they start with the level 5 starting gold?
Newbies do have money, yes.
Yeah, that's what I was asking.
Okay.
Yeah, so you should have 500 plus, I think it's
500 plus the magic
item. Plus a d10 times 25 gold pieces. I want to say it is. I don't have my DMG handy.
Do you happen to remember what page that was on?
48, I think? 38?
38. You know, 500 gold, and the three of you roll me a d10.
Oh, I knew it was a d10. I was close. Come on, d10. Where's my blue d10? I'm liking the blue dice. They seem to be good for me. Come on, d10. Ooh!
Rylus.
That's a 9.
Bastard.
Oh, I got a 4.
Bastard!
Everybody keep your dice there for a second.
Yeah. And she moved.
I strained it so you could see it.
He moved it to a 7. I still have more than you.
Okay, and yeah, for Grabender, I believe what you told me is that I was lucky because they didn't find the platinum pieces I had. So,
did you keister the platinum pieces?
Apparently. They saw all the gold and silver and took it.
Yeah, they saw mass quantities of gold and silver.
Like 90 pounds of gold and silver?
Definitely drew their attention more than the couple of platinum pieces.
Yeah, I had 15 platinum pieces.
And thousands of gold and silver.
Yeah.
Thank you, Grabender.
Cumulatively, not necessarily quantitative.
That's awesome. Maybe.
Whatever works.
Way to go, Grabender.
So, our group currently has 160 gold to their name.
Okay.
That makes me sad.
Yeah. No.
Next time we'll spend it while we have it.
Yeah, let's not get knocked out and have our loot taken from us. You had 26,000 gold worth of items. I bet you feel sad.
I'm very sad.
Anyway, in character. So, we have the gold. We walk, we get some sleep, we rearm, and we take the fight back to our foes.
Sounds like a plan if I've ever heard one.
You have the right of it. Let us go.
We walk.
Right.
Now we need the Grabender walk.
I'm sorry. I'm not readjusting the camera. I've got it perfectly situated.
This is not even fair.
Just imagine me. I'm doing it.
It's like this.
Not even funny. That damn guy. Oh, he's gonna show up in my dreams next time. Damn it, guys. It's like his head was on Gryffindor's screen and his body was on Lucas's.
Oh, that's, yeah, we could do that. We could totally be like, I've got a body.
Like, oh, look.
Portal.
Okay.
Yeah, moving on. Vault Boy has infested D&D.
The party marches on, and it only takes a couple of hours. They make it to the outskirts of a small town.
Oh, what a cute little town.
Up about there-ish.
Oh, it's so cute! I love this town.
So we're coming in from the north?
Yes.
Yeah. This way.
So, that is the party. Ish.
Alright, John. I'd like to see the map that... Never mind.
I am
basically just shifted.
Okay.
It's rotated 90 degrees counterclockwise.
That's good. So we're actually coming from the east.
Yes.
But it's north on the current view.
Yes.
I like it.
Excellent.
Did they leave Cognar with his... I think it's still in my backpack. And I think I'm still wearing it. My company uniform?
Yes.
Okay. So he's not completely naked. So I'm not going to scare some people. That's good.
That is very important.
It's very important. Ooh, arrows.
That's north.
Yep.
True north. Not magnetic north. Alright. Cool.
Maybe both.
Oh, God, it's one of those worlds.
They're one and the same.
It's magic. Okay. Who is best suited to lead us into the city?
Rylet's going to step up and say, perhaps I should do that. Excuse me. Perhaps I should do that.
By all means, lead the way.
After you, good sir.
And Ryleth's totally going to take the lead and start wandering into the city looking for places of business where one might procure items.
Oh, I still have to look at my ox.
So there look to be a couple simple vendors with kind of various sorts of farming supplies and such. As you guys are kind of making your way further into town, there looks to be a tavern, a smaller inn, and as you make your way closer, you recognize the docks that you guys sailed by earlier down there. You can see several granaries, some rundown-looking cottages, and a couple of shops. But like, they're not even up to kind of like Red Larch quality. They seem very simple, very basic, like the bare minimum is in the shops.
Well, the first place I'm going to go is to the inn.
All right.
Yeah, I'm following.
Yeah, we are grouping this. We are all following.
And as we get closer, I'm going to look at Mushi and say, "Friend, I mean no disrespect, but given everything that has been going on in this region recently, perhaps you could, well, wear a hood for a while."
I am not ashamed of who I am. And I do not fear what the people will think or say. And I know better than they are. I know better than them who I am. If they have a problem, they can always take it up with me.
I do not intend to imply that you should be ashamed. Simply that our business may go more smoothly if they are not immediately aware that a tiefling is among them.
I said what I need to say. And I will not put a hood on my horse.
Very well.
I don't have a hood to put on my horse.
And he walks into the inn.
All right. So walking into the inn, you're immediately greeted by a pleasant smelling fire in the hearth as some sort of wood cackles and burns inside. And a short, plump woman greets you as soon as the door opens up.
Oh, please, hello, welcome, 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 welcome to the Walford Inn. How many rooms can I get for you? You want all three? I suppose I'll give you a discount if you're looking to empty those pockets of yours. Kick back, relax, spend some time in a quaint little town such as our own. Don't want to be outside when dark falls. The Womford Bat will sweep you up.
The Womford Bat? Please tell me more.
Oh, there'll be plenty of time for that later. How long will you be staying?
Well, for now, let us just plan on staying the one night.
Just the one night?
Well, for now, we may...
possibly take in everything that our quaint little town of Womford has to offer you just one night.
Well, we may become enchanted by your town and decide to spend longer, but for now, we are on our trip, traveling through the area, so we plan on staying for tonight only for now.
Oh, well, if you insist. How many rooms was it?
I believe we're going to need three rooms.
Ooh, all three. All right, very well. And you said you're staying for two nights.
Just the one, actually, but we will take dinner.
Oh, well, I'm afraid we haven't got much of a kitchen, but I could give you the rooms for 16 silver total for the three.
I guarantee
you won't find a better price at any other inn in Walford, as we're the only inn in Walford.
I thought you might be. How about 16 silver for the rooms and dinner? Whatever your kitchen can provide.
We haven't got much of a kitchen.
It's fine if you just have bread and cheeses, fruits, and anything.
Oh, very well then. Roll me a persuasion check.
Excellent.
Please tell me you made your character around persuasion.
More or less.
Because if you don't...
14.
Oh.
14.
That's good.
Not
awesome. He's got a plus 5.
Suppose we can make that. We can make do. As long as you're not expecting something luxurious.
No, of course not.
Well then, by all means, 16 silver it is.
And I'll pay the 16 silver.
And with that, welcome to our humble little town of Walford.
So 16 silver, that would be 2 gold, and I get 4 silver back?
Yep.
All right.
She's happy to make change.
Now, madam, could you perhaps direct me to the town blacksmith?
Oh, we haven't got much of a blacksmith. Dareth used to kind of tinker about with some of the tools, but the bat swooped him up right from his own doorstep the other night. So, I'm afraid what we've got now is, well, what we've got. Unless you've brought some of your own wares to sell. I hear there's an opening for a blacksmith in the town, if you're interested.
You say your blacksmith was swooped and picked up from his own doorstep.
Like I said, the one for bat. You want to stay clear of that one. Don't leave. Don't be outside near nightfall.
Perhaps you would tell us more of this Womford Bat now.
Sure. It's a monstrous creature. Flies about at night. Swoops up women, children, men. Anyone out late making too much of a ruckus.
Where does this bat come from?
Heavens if I know. I wouldn't be caught dead in the middle of night trying to ask that guy where he came from?
But surely no bat is big enough to carry a person.
Well, now that your room's paid for, you're more than welcome to wait outside and find out for yourselves. So well, if you wouldn't mind making sure the door is firmly shut behind you.
Well, good madam, perhaps you could show us to our rooms, and then I know you said your blacksmith is, well, missing, but if you could direct me to his shop.
Oh, certainly, certainly. So the rooms are going to be these three doors right here. She points to her right, and there's a series of doors fairly spaced apart. And she says, as for the blacksmith's shop, well, his wares, I'm sure you can find those about the marketplace. When I say marketplace, ever so lightly. There's a couple of shops set up in the open square. Like I said, you probably want to get there before nightfall, as the shops are bound to be closing up soon.
Well, then I believe we shall make our way there immediately. Thank you very much. We will be back.
Oh, thank you, and welcome to Womford.
And
as we exit the shop, I would like to mutter under my breath, I'm so glad I made it so much more difficult to get a room. And I will walk out.
I only heard him say he walked in. I didn't hear you say you walked in.
Oh, we all walked in. I thought we all walked in as a group.
I thought it was just him.
I said I walked in.
Yeah, that's all I heard.
I assumed we all walked in.
No, we were standing outside saying, yeah, well,
you guys are chatting about who can work iron better.
Whatever, okay. Well, then I was outside and I'll keep my mouth shut.
Oof. I'm going to step back out and say,
talk about my horns again.
We have three rooms for the night at a relatively reasonable price. There is some to do about a bat that has been stealing people from town, but the most important thing is that their blacksmith has been stolen. We may find some of his wares in the market, but we may have to snoop around a bit to find his shop.
Do you know the whereabouts of where his shop may be? It seems to be a decently sized town.
I could not get a straight answer from the chatty lady at the inn. But surely someone around town will be able to direct us.
Dangle's gonna ask Leith and Ryleth,
do you want me to find and break into this blacksmith shop? I can do that.
And I'm gonna telepathically tell him, let's not mention break in quite so loudly.
I meant it as a whisper. Yes. I can't whisper as his voice.
Okay.
That's a hard voice to whisper.
But yes, please.
How about we find
around town to try to find the shop?
Open.
All right, Dangle is going to break off. And
all right,
he's gonna stealth about and look for anything that looks like a blacksmith shop.
All right, so roll me a stealth check for Dangle.
The Dangle.
That's really good. 24.
You have advantage, don't you?
No.
Because of your cloak?
I don't have a cloak.
Oh, you picked the bag of holding, didn't you?
And the hat of disguise.
Yeah.
Yep.
Everyone 24. Else has the same.
24.
24, all right. Dangle steps away from the party and seems to disappear behind a couple that walks by.
And I'm going to start going towards what I assume to be the market in that big open area there in the middle of town.
All right.
Do I see just any shops or anything?
Yeah, you do see a couple of market stands set up. A couple have various leather works on them. One of them has a couple of weapons.
clubs, daggers, axes, maces, basically the simple melee weapons. Well, a couple of simple ranged weapons can be found on this market stand.
Let's see, how much gold does Cognar have? Do we see anybody selling javelins? Do I see any javelin-esque items?
Yes, you do. There look to be a couple crudely carved sticks resting on this market stall.
Cognar will walk up.
Greetings, traveler. How can I be of assistance?
Well, there's one thing I'm looking for. Sharp, pointy sticks I can throw really far.
Oh, I've got plenty.
All right. Well,
you look to be a man who certainly knows your worth of weaponry.
I do. I'm a blacksmith. I work with weapons all the time.
Oh, in that case, you will be sure to note this esteemed craftsmanship of these javelins from the far west. They say that these javelins can travel through the air at the speed of light, piercing through your enemies, slaying your foes with but a single throw.
He's going to insight check this guy just to see how much full of shit he is worth.
All right, go ahead.
Oh my god. Wait, what do I got? Okay. oh, that sucks. Insight. 7.
So Cognar has heard tales of various kind of magical weapons of sorts that are able to kind of lock in on targets and deal more damage when a target is specified before it's thrown. And what he's describing sounds similar to that.
Well, the item sure sounds magnificent.
Oh, I assure you, it's well worth your coin.
How much coin are we talking?
Well, as we've established, you yourself seem to be a craftsman of a particular nature who could so appreciate a finely tuned weapon. A javelin that never misses like this is rare, I assure you. How much are you looking to spend per javelin?
Well, seeing as I have made javelins in the past, no more than 6 silver.
6 silver.
Let me a persuasion check.
Yeah, I'm checking my background feature to make sure I'm not fucking something up here. I guess I probably should have mentioned that before we went looking for people. All right, what am I rolling?
Right. persuasion check.
14 persuasion. Let's see. 14 plus... Oh, 18.
18?
Yes.
All right. I suppose I could part with such weapons for 6 silver apiece. After all, you are proficient with such tools, and you recognize them for their worth.
Indeed. I will take 6.
6? Oh my.
Yeah.
Is there anything else that I can get for you?
You wouldn't happen to have any warhammers laying around, would you?
I'm afraid not. We've been without our local blacksmith for a few days now, and unfortunately even he could probably incapable of crafting such a weapon.
At this point, Grabinder's going to walk up and there were like this was basically the only shop that seemed to have weapons, right?
Pretty much, yeah.
Okay, then he's going to pull out the note that the abbot gave him and show it to the shopkeep and say, "Perhaps you could also assist us with this. We are looking to acquire some basic items, armor and weapons, to protect this realm."
And he takes the note from you, and he takes a moment to scan it over. His tone noticeably changes as he takes the javelins that he had placed up on the countertop and kind of ring them up, and he tosses them back behind the counter, and he says, most certainly, what can I provide for the lot of you?"
"Well, we do not wish to take much. We understand that you have a business, and we will pay what we can. But perhaps you have, well, any type of armor or simple weapons, a mace perhaps, a short bow, arrows, anything of this nature that would be of assistance to us."
"Certainly. Cynthia! Cynthia!" He calls out, and a woman's standing kind of close by at one of the houses kind of perks up. "Cynthia, go inside and get the leather armor I had crafted but a few days ago. Just the one."
"Well, I know that
we both be needing a set of armor."
Cognar stands okay, illustrator. "I don't need any armor."
Out of character, two questions.
Yeah.
One, is Mushi there and does she need stuff?
She just got back.
"I am here, but I don't need any weapons or armor, so I'm good."
Okay. And two,
even a quarterstaff?
I could use a quarterstaff because now I don't have my glass staff or my quarterstaff because I gave it to a villager. But I mean, I really have never used it either, so.
Yeah, but it doesn't hurt to have one.
It doesn't hurt. If he has the quarterstaff, I will take it.
And I was also curious, ranged weapons. Like, I was trying to see if there was something that said ranged weapons always use dex modifiers instead of strength modifiers.
Ranged weapons like crossbows, bows, yes, they use the dexterity, but for thrown weapons like javelins, hand axes, daggers, and the like, ones that have the finesse property, you can use strength. Basically, I would say, even if it doesn't have the finesse, you can use strength or dexterity. But I think they all have finesse.
I know.
So like a hand axe doesn't have the finesse property, but I could say you could absolutely use your strength modifier for that.
Okay, because mainly it was just like, well, I checked the property, right? The cleric has proficiency with all simple weapons. It didn't say all simple melee, it says all simple weapons. And so I was thinking, you know, with the limited armor I'm about to have, being able to use a bow would be kind of handy.
Alright.
Anything that with the thrown property can be used with strength. And then so anything for raised with finesse weapons can be both.
Yeah, I was looking more like a short bow.
I believe that's separate entirely.
Yeah, I mean, it says thrown. There's a section on thrown, but just ranged weapons?
Right.
I think it's dex.
This thing, I can't find where it says that.
Yeah, I can't either. well, it'd probably be under, like, ranged attack roll? Maybe? Attacks?
Yeah, I'll look in the attack section. Yeah.
Everybody look, quick. Actions in combat. Ranged attacks. No, it doesn't actually say that you have to use dexterity or strength.
So, page 177... under dexterity. attack rolls and damage. You add your dexterity modifier to your attack roll and your damage roll when attacking with a ranged weapon, such as a sling or a longbow.
Okay. I said I was pretty sure that's what it took, but I just couldn't find it.
Yeah.
Okay. Still.
But if he's... You can throw javelins, so.
Well, no, I was just thinking, I mean, if he's got a short bow and some arrows and a mace, I'll take both.
Short bow or crossbow? Short bow. Okay.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I think a crossbow is a military or martial weapon.
You can use a light crossbow.
Yeah, light crossbow.
Which does more damage.
Hey, I'll take a light crossbow.
I would say that's a little bit more strength than a short bow.
So, completely... Mm-hmm. Completely like more, but not out of character, but metagaming, I guess.
Whatever
the term is, the short bow only does 1d6 of piercing, whereas a crossbow does 1d8, but it does take an action to reload the light crossbow because it's a two-handed crossbow.
Right.
So you would get less shots with the light crossbow than you would a short bow. But it would do slightly more damage.
Looking at the loading requirement, it just means that you can only attack with it once per turn. So as part of your action, you can load with it. You just can't use it again on your turn. You can only fire one piece of ammunition from it when you use an action.
So regardless of the number of attacks you can normally make.
Correct, unless you have the feat. Which allows you to attack multiple times. So you can still do it once per turn.
Okay, yeah, then let's go with a crossbow. He's got one.
All right. Most certainly.
Same price.
And you can hear him open up, and he bends down, and he opens up a small cabinet on his side of the kiosk, and he pulls out a rusted, slightly rusted, but still functional crossbow. He plants it up on top, and a small quiver of 20 bolts. As Cynthia comes up a moment later with a set of studded leather armor in her hands, and she drapes that on top of the crossbow. And the man ducks down underneath the counter once again, pulls out three. They look to be similarly. I want to just say spears, just carved wood, much like the javelins that he had up top before, but these are significantly straighter, like noticeably much more time has been put into crafting these, as he places three of these javelins up on top of the leather, and he takes a moment leaning on over towards your side of the kiosk as he looks over his wares, and yes, and he picks up a heavy looking mace. And that as well. Will this be all?
We thank you very, very much.
Quarterstaff.
Quarterstaff.
Ah. And yes, for...
You're the one that's... If
you happen to have a quarterstaff.
Oh, most certainly. And he takes one of the javelins he had up on the counter a moment ago. He picks up one of the hand axes and chops off the pointed tip.
Wait, he was trying to actually give me sticks? Pass.
And I'm going to reach into my bag and pull out 5 platinum pieces.
Whoa.
And the look on his face is just that of pure awe. As he goes completely silent, but his mouth is...
He's only got 8 intelligence.
And I'm going to say, I know this is not much, but please, take this.
I am not in there. Lucas, you stop him.
I actually have less intelligence than Grabender, so I'm fucking stupid.
So, his arms visibly quiver as he reaches out for the coins and kind of cups his hands. Just thank you. Thank you.
You have done us a great favor. What is your name, friend?
My name is Marcus. What is yours, friend?
My name is Grabinder Dravas. And oh, Marcus, we shall spread the word of your shop and tell the people once we have conquered the evil in this land that Marcus of
Womford
was critical to our success.
Oh, most appreciated indeed. Cynthia, take a note of this name. Grabinder, I'm sorry, what was...
Dravas.
You heard him, Cynthia. Write it down. As she kind of rolls her eyes and heads back towards the small house that she just emerged from. So, Mr. Grabinder, with such a generous gift, I would feel loath to donate for a little myself. If you would be so kind as to humble me by accepting, and he reaches down into the cupboard once more, pulls out a red cork bottle that you clearly identify as a healing potion.
Why? Again, Marcus, thank you. Thank you so much. I promise this will go to a great cause.
Says, and I cannot promise the same with your coin, but I assure you it is appreciated.
I'll take
and,
it.
Takes
a moment to kind of like realize what he says. Like, oh no. I simply meant to insinuate this. The majority of this coin will be spent on alcohol of varying sorts and degrees.
I like the way you think. My javelin's working.
And, Marcus, if I may, one last thing. Do you carry shields?
Yes.
He just had a great idea.
Ah! As he reaches down, you can hear him tugging and straining at something before the small hand axe raises up again and an audible chop is heard. Oh, as he comes, pops back up top the door of the cabinet. The small strap on it. Says, this should function most, as best as it could, I suppose.
Oh my god. So awesome.
I appreciate your your ingenuity.
Oh my god. I love this guy.
And I appreciate your generosity.
5 platinum for a door.
Oh right. My god.
Cogner's already out of the room.
I'm going to like collect our things and go. So I have a healing potion. I now have
a door.
A functional door shield. I assume it's functional.
Absolutely.
It's a wooden
is
shield.
It still
a it's a wooden shield.
Oh, it is a door shield. Yes, now in my inventory is a door shield.
Yes. Door shield.
Studded armor, you
I
said?
I adore you.
Studded leather armor, yep.
12 plus your no dex, right? Or do you have dex?
I'm pretty sure it's a 10, so I have no dex. But it's better than the 10 I had.
Yeah, it's plus 2. Plus
it's something.
Plus your shield, that makes you add a whole whopping 14 armor.
Ooh, wait. Nazgrabender's kind of turning away with this pile of gear in his arms. Marcus leans back over toward, attentioning his focus towards Cognar and says, there are still some more javelins if you would wish to purchase. If you still wish to make the purchase. And he picks the javelins back up from the ground and places all 5 of them now.
And the crooked stick-looking things?
Yep.
No, my friend, this is just fine. Enjoy your ale tonight.
Well, thank you then.
And I walk out. And I walk away.
Okay, now, completely out of character.
Yes.
You know, just so you guys don't think I was being ridiculous, I gave the guy 5 platinum, which is equivalent to 50 gold.
Yes.
And he gave me like 150 gold worth of stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, but we also had a free pass for everything.
Not necessarily for everything.
Not for everything. Anyway, he gave Miyushi a stick.
I got a stick.
So you have a quarterstaff.
I already took my
I have a mace. I assume it's just a regular old mace.
Lucas is just jealous that he didn't get one of the sticks. That Miyushi took the favorite stick.
When he decided to chop the end off the stick, Cognar was, as a weaponsmith himself, was pissed. So he was like, screw that, I don't want your sticks.
But he wanted them before.
Hey, he only had none of his weapons. Anyway.
You have a scimitar.
I have 2 now, actually. Yeah, he doesn't know how to dual wield, but he's going to do it anyway until he can find a door of his own. Does Dangle find anything?
Yeah. If the rest of the party is wrapped up with Marcus, then we will turn to Dangle.
Are we?
Let me just be sure. So, the mace is just regular old mace. The light crossbow, no, nothing special about it, nothing special about the... Just straight from the table.
Yep.
Okay.
And a potion of healing.
Excellent.
Where you go, potion of healing?
Alright. So, Dangle
yep.
has just assured the group that he is going to sneak around and vanishes in the shadows surrounding one of the buildings, disappearing into the very sparse crowd here in Wamper as he begins skulking about town. What would Dangle like to do?
Well, Dangle's gonna look for a chimney, because that's what a blacksmith would have. So he's going to be looking around for a chimney and or signs that say blacksmith.
All right. Roll me an investigation check for Dangle.
Yeah, of course. Oh. Damn. It's a good thing he's got expertise in it. A 10.
10? All right. So Dangle sees a series of chimneys in the majority of these houses. There was even a chimney in the building that Grubender had just walked out of. Mm-hmm. But he does not see any kind of signs that would indicate a blacksmith's shop, forge or shop or anything.
Let's see. And we didn't hear any indication of where it might be. All right. Well, he's gonna keep looking around a little bit longer.
All right.
Just keep perusing.
Dangle begins perusing some of the local houses as he looks, peeks through some of the windows looking for a blacksmith. You can see several families kind of sitting down for meals. He pokes his head into one window and sees one man in a state of undress.
Undressed or undressed?
Undress.
Okay.
As he continues round one house to another, making his way through yard after another, climbing various trees just because he can.
Yep.
Running through one of the fields. He feels like he has fairly completely scouted out the entirety of Wamford in a matter of 30 minutes tops.
And found he has nothing that looks like a blacksmith.
Circling all the way around. Nothing visibly standing out as a blacksmith.
All right. Did he look at the dock? By chance?
Yeah.
Okay. Nothing at the dock.
Or the other side of the river?
Or the other side of the river? Because once he finishes with the town, he's gonna look to the other side of the river, and if there's more buildings, he's gonna walk over there.
There's like just a couple more. Like they seem to get more and more sparse.
Mm-hmm.
But there are a couple over there.
Okay. He would like to go investigate. He's gonna check everything out just to see what it is. He's a goblin. He likes to look for goodies.
All right. So, roll me another stealth check as he makes his way across the bridge.
As water elemental comes.
Yes. That's a 22.
All right. So Dangle begins making his way across this large stone bridge, and a visible ox cart begins coming up from the other side, taking up the majority of this small bridge.
Mm-hmm.
As Dangle quickly ducks out of sight, keeping himself down below the height of the kind of railways. Mm-hmm. Either side of the bridge, the man kind of directing the ox cart seems to take no notice of Dangle. Oof. As the cart just narrowly passes by Dangle, leaving very little room between the stone wall, Dangle, and the ox cart as it continues on by.
Is there anything that looks of value on the cart?
Roll me.
Yes.
And if you're...
just
if you want
just...
to like...
just looking in the bags.
Roll me a perception check.
Oh! That's 23.
So you can see, as you peek your head up after it passes by, a series of what looks to be kind of various haystacks in the back of the car.
Just hay. Alright, so he's gonna wait, look, and then he's gonna hop back up on the bridge and stealthily trot across the bridge towards the rest of the houses down there.
All right. Dangle makes his way around to the other side of the bridge.
Is this a really big house on the left?
It looks to be a house with a somewhat larger chimney to it.
He's going to look there first. Big houses means loot.
All right, so Dangle makes his way around, and he can see what looks to be a stable of sorts that has since been emptied,
mm-hmm.
as well as a what looks to be a cold forge furnace.
Okay, is there any windows to the inside?
There are a couple, like, around the house.
Can you get a bead on the inside, see if there's anybody inside?
Sure, roll me a perception check.
six.
All right, so... the windows seem to be covered with some kind of grimy soot. Like, mm-hmm. the more Dangle rubs to kind of get a view into it, the worse he's making it.
Okay. Is there a second floor?
There is not.
Okay. He's going to look around, and if he doesn't see anybody out in the open, he's going to try to just get into the front door.
All right, so roll me one more perception check. Kind of gaze about the
natural 20
buildings around. All right, so you look around and you see a small girl kind of standing a ways away whose attention seems to have been piqued by the small gnome that's peeking into a window and keeps wiping it in front of him, who is turned around and kind of looking around himself.
And
small girl stands in a nearby field. Yeah, she seems to be staring right at you.
Okay, which field is she in? Like the left or the right?
Right thereabouts.
Okay. If I notice that, I'm gonna walk over to her.
All right.
And I'm gonna ask her, "Do you know what happened to the blacksmith?"
Maurice says the blacksmith got swept up by the bat.
The bat, you say?
She says that's why I have to eat my vegetables, or else the bat will get me.
Well, she's absolutely right, but do you know when the blacksmith got swooped up?
I'm going to have to make an intelligence check.
See.
must have been a few 10 day now. It can't have been too long. Weeks ago, I guess.
Has anybody been inside?
Not that I saw. Why? What's inside?
I don't know. I'm investigating his disappearance. I'm trying to see if there's anything that the bat might want from him.
Well, what would the bat want from him?
I don't know. That's what I'm here to find out.
Oh, okay.
Do you want to come investigate with me?
Well, am I allowed?
Sure.
I don't want to get in trouble.
It'll be all right.
Oh, then. Okay.
He's gonna get Crowley the girl steps killed. Steps up
closer to the gnome in front of her.
All right. I'm gonna start walking towards the blacksmith.
All right. She's trailing right by your side as the two of you make your way up to the blacksmith's shop. And her hand reaches for the front door. She jingles it, and it doesn't seem to budge. She
says, oh, I think it's locked. I'm sorry.
Do you know if there's a back door?
She just visibly shrugs her shoulders.
Why don't you go look around back, and I'll see if I can pry this door open.
Roll me a persuasion check.
What's my persuasion? Oh, God. 11.
Okay.
And she takes off running around the shop.
All right, as soon as she's around the corner, I'm going to try to thief stool the door.
All right. Go ahead and give me a thief's check.
15.
Tools check. 15 total?
Yes.
So after a few moments of working with your tools, you hear the audible click and the handle begins to turn.
And I'll yell out, I got the door open!
She comes running right back around the corner. She says, there's no door!
Oh. Well, doesn't hurt to try. You want to go inside and investigate?
She nods her head.
Okay, lead the way.
But the door's locked.
Try it now.
She reaches for the handle and it turns. And she
What did you do?
I don't know.
Well, let's go find out.
And she jumps inside of this house.
I cautiously walk behind her.
All right. So you walk in and you can see what looks to be a...
For real.
Relatively quaint house. That seems to be gaining a bit of dust and cobwebs in some of the corners. There is a large armchair by a hearth here inside. The hearth is kind of positioned on the same wall that the forge fire is on the exterior, mm-hmm. sharing the same chimney.
Okay.
There's a couple of bookshelves, not very populated with books. There are some documents. Table, some cupboards, a straw bed in one corner, very kind of simple means, pots, clay pots.
Okay. Do I see any blacksmithing equipment?
You do not.
No weapons, no nothing.
No.
But this looked to be a forge, right?
There, from the outside, yes. Mm-hmm. There is a large pair of iron tongs by the fireplace. But aside from that, no particular forgery items.
I might be spacing. Did she say that this was the blacksmith's house?
Or she did
we
not.
Just no. Break into a random house?
You just broke into this house.
Ah, shit.
With a small child.
Here, child, you open the door. It wasn't me, it was you.
She did. I thought this was the blacksmith's house.
And she says,
well, he lives here, yeah.
Do you know where his shop is?
And she nods her head.
Can you show me?
And she darts off running, kind of bumping into Dangle as she runs through the doorway he's standing in. And she takes a sharp right, circling around into the kind of stable area behind Dangle. And she says,
this is where he works on stuff.
She says, pointing at the large forge furnace.
Oh, that's nice.
Fireplace.
All right. Well, I don't know. What do you determine from this investigation? Do you think he had anything of worth that a bat might take from him?
She shrugs her shoulders.
I don't know.
Yeah. I'm gonna walk back inside, and I'm gonna put the dwarven tankard on a table.
All right.
And then I'm gonna call out to her. I think I might have found something.
She comes running back to the doorway where Daniel's standing. She says, what?
You see that mug over there?
Yeah.
I think that might be it.
Well, if the bat wants it, we shouldn't take it.
I think you're right. We might want to leave this place.
Says, okay, and she reaches for the door handle. He is slowly closing the door.
Yep. And I say, okay, run along. Now, if you tell anybody about this, the bat might try to come and get you. It's looking for people investigating, so be careful.
And you can see face slowly starting to pout. As a single tear starts to stream from her cheek as she takes off running.
Okay. As soon as she turns around, I'm going to change my disguise. into something different. And I'm going to go back in and grab my tankard and then walk out. Walk back to
town. All right. So what is your passive stealth?
That's a good question. Passive stealth is a... Oh, wait, that's Cognar. Passive stealth for him is a 19.
19, alright. So, and what are you changing your disguise into?
Let's see, I went from gnome, so I'm gonna go something completely different from a gnome. I'm gonna go with a, I'm gonna go with a halfling, or not a halfling, a half-elf.
Half-elf, all right.
Half-elf, different color hair. And, all right. Actually, we'll say an old half-elf female. There we go. Something completely different.
All right. You shift into an old half-elf female as you exit the blacksmith's house.
And I will try to cautiously walk back into town.
All right.
I didn't see anything at the forge, right? Just a forge.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. So, in the meantime...
God, I feel terrible.
Cognar, Grubender, Ryleth, Mushi, and Leith. What have the five of you gotten yourselves into?
Well, we're not trapping children for bats, that's for sure.
I wasn't either.
Yeah, Grubender, after dealing with the shopkeeper, is just going to go back to the inn, because he's pretty worn out. Yeah. So he's going to go try to get some food and go to bed.
Yeah, Cognar is going to go back to the inn, get a drink, and then go to bed.
Miesha's gonna wait for everyone else to enter the inn before she enters it. Visibly offended.
from what? Oh, from Ryla. Oh, yeah.
But she will not enter alone. She'll make sure there's others with her.
Ryleth isn't going back to the inn yet.
I know, but I'm just saying, Miesha will not enter the inn alone. She'll probably go with Cognar and Gurbinder. That's her groupies.
Cognar's gonna grab her by the sleeve and say, "We need a drink."
And she will.
So where's the inn?
I was just gonna say this one's the inn right there.
Okay.
Yeah. Cognar's there.
So Cognar's at the inn or the tavern?
Oh. Oh, they're not the same.
Has it been like an hour?
Shit. Cognar's drinking. Where's the tavern?
I'm gonna say this one right there.
Alright. Cognar's over there drinking.
Alright.
Miesha will have a drink with him, why not?
And then after we've had a couple drinks, then I'm going to the inn.
Yes, then we will go to the inn. And Leith is being Leith. I have nothing to do. I don't know. She'll go to the inn and rest, because she is exhausted from chopping down that tree.
All right, so first question is, which room does Leith go to?
Because
there are three rooms, and one of them is occupied.
She will go to an unoccupied room.
All right. And Gurbinder, as you open the door to your room, you see placed on your pillow case a single loaf of bread.
Awesome.
And Leith, when you enter the room at the inn, there's another loaf of bread atop that pillowcase in there.
I do love bread. And she's going to walk up to this bread and inspect it. It is very different than what she's used to. And she's going to poke it, and then she's going to tear a piece off and smell it.
Poke it with her.
And she's going to look around, and then she's going to put a little piece in her mouth and chew it.
So Leith begins learning what bread is.
Yes. She's from far, far away, guys. She doesn't understand things yet.
Is there anything Ryleth would like to be doing at this point in time?
Yeah, Ryleth was going to go check around town and try to find people to talk to about the Womford Bat and the blacksmith.
All right.
Too bad. You're going to the inn. No.
All right, so I suppose where would Ryleth like to start first?
I guess, are there people just like, you know, just wandering around?
There are several people just kind of wandering about randomly. As the sun's getting lower, they seem to kind of be rushing to finish their business. Marcus and Cynthia begin kind of packing up the shop, as do some of the other kind of shopkeepers.
Okay, let's go over and talk to Marcus.
Coming over the bridge, there's a large oxen wagon heading east.
Okay.
So as you step up, Marcus greets you. Oh, hello, friend. We are starting to close up shop for the evening, so if there's anything you'd like, I'm afraid you're going to have to be quick about it.
And he's going to put on his biggest smile and just make, you know, his most friendly half-elf appearance. And he's going to ask, I've been hearing the strangest rumors. Could you perhaps tell me about this Womford Bat?
He says, well, if you ask me, it's little more than an old wives' tale. That mothers tell their children to get them to do various chores about the home. More or less to obey. It's the boogeyman of sorts of Womford.
The innkeeper had just informed me that your blacksmith was stolen by it. That must be most strange.
Well, You know, when people believe in such superstitious things, they'll find excuses to make them seem more lively. When they find a little other reason to explain their happenstance.
Well, obviously, you don't believe that the bat is responsible for the blacksmith's disappearance.
Of course not. You can't blame a man for wanting to get out of Walmford. I mean, it's cozy and comfortable, but significantly lacking for other folk who aspire for greater things.
Then you think the blacksmith simply packed up and moved, trying to find better prospects?
But I don't see why not. He seemed to be more often paid with favors and the like rather than actual coin. And if you wanted to improve his state of well-being, then I suppose I would do much of the same.
Well, that is certainly understandable. Everyone seems to be in a bit of a rush to get in now that it's getting dark.
As I said, Womper Bat, those who don't believe in these superstitions of it tend to draw a stop to all their business because of those who do. You see, I don't seem to make many sales after dark because everyone tends to stick to their homes. It's sort of a self-fulfilling prophecy, if you will. Those who believe in it stay inside. That draws the business that I could be having. And so as a result, I close up my own shop to keep my own sanity about me.
Well, I will take no more of your time, good man.
Very well, very well. Good day to you.
Good day to you as well.
Continues kind of packing up this little stand.
And can I insight check him just to kind of get a feel for whether he's actually telling me the truth?
Sure.
That will be a 13.
Oh. All right, so he seems fairly sincere in what he's saying. He believes himself to be speaking the truth, that it's basically he hasn't seen Sasquatch, so why should he believe in it?
Right.
There might be people who swear all their being they have seen Sasquatch, but as far as this guy goes, it's just an old wives' tale.
Got it.
Whether it's true or not, his face doesn't really say, but he doesn't believe in this at all.
All right. Well, that's just kind of going to wander about town a little bit, keeping an eye on people, just to kind of observe. And eventually make his way back to the inn.
All right. So, meanwhile, Cognar and Mushi make their way into the tavern, where they see a fairly small crowd of people kind of gathered about some of the tables and the like, fairly deep in their drink. Kind of early for most taverns that you might think, but you know, with the town being kind of closed at dark, they seem to be kind of making up for it by getting more drink in early. As a number of faces kind of turn to see the movement in the doorway as the strangers are now entering, a singular face in the crowd is recognizable as that of Barrow Gladham, the man that the party rescued in the Air Cultist Temple.
Oh.
He has my quarterstaff. I will not say that out loud.
He does.
I'm not saying that out loud. I'm just excited.
Right.
Yeah, because he's the one you told to protect your quarterstaff with his life.
Yes.
That's right. That is
the one. He clocked you in the face with it.
Yeah, he did good. He protected my quarterstaff.
Oh, my good shot.
Because clearly that piece of stick. Never mind.
It's worth more than his life.
Oh, good heavens! What brings you folks to Walmford? Bartender, a round for them, please.
kind of grizzly-looking older man seems to hesitate for a moment before grabbing a couple of mugs from the countertop and filling them up from one of the barrels and slamming them on the bar in front of him. Says, come, drink, please.
I'll come over, grab the ale with one hand and slap him on the back with the other. Sounds like you made it out all right.
Absolutely, thanks to you lot. Weren't there more of you before?
Ah, well, they're tucking it in for the night.
Oh, well, I suppose that's understandable. Don't want to be out after dark, after all. You know, Womford.
Yes, we've been hearing a lot about that. What's the word?
Oh, the word is I'm still alive, thanks to you folk. I intend to live it to the very fullest. What brings you folk here, of all places? Last I encountered you, it was somewhere in the middle of the mountains.
Well,
our travels have led us quite astray. However, we'll be back up there shortly. I didn't know you were from down south. I guess we didn't have much chit-chat when we first met.
You know, not too far from home, but trying to stay relatively close in case you happen across my wife. Were you able to venture further into the temple and find her? Had you anything to report?
Unfortunately, we were captured ourselves, and we barely escaped with our lives. We are on our way back to avenge not only ourselves, but look for more survivors.
Oh. Well, I'm sincerely happy to hear that you are still alive and that you escaped their clutches, as I can speak a little more than most as to what horrors they can put upon you. Oh, but that reminds me, your friend, the one at the spire, do thank him for the lot of us, as his hospitality was most welcome. He saw to it that most of us were scattered about and returned as best as he was able to, as he associated some of his knights to fly various folks home.
One second.
I'm afraid it may have slipped some of their minds to thank him, so please, if you come across him again, please give him our very best.
I would love to. Do you know if any of the knights stayed around?
No, none that stayed around here, no, but as I said, we came from scattered directions in the world and seem to have returned there.
I'm back.
Do you know of a way we can contact them?
Says,
did they
suppose you could write if you must? They didn't leave it much word, but, and he kind of goes around and he fumbles with a little backpack that he's got down by his feet. And he pulls out a fairly large sack and he plants it on the bar in front of Cognar and says, this is a gift from all of us. It's by no means enough to repay you for what you did for us, but it's our own means of saying thank you.
Cognar will take a peek at it. He's not going to open it up completely. He just wants to get the gist of what's inside.
That's what he sees, just kind of taking a peek.
Well, in that case, let me buy you a round.
He says, I'll drink to that. And he finishes the mug that he's got and sets down the empty glass.
I'm gonna slap down a gold. Keep filling his mug until he can't drink anymore. And I'll slap him on the back and I'm gonna take my mug and just go sit down. Grabbing the sack.
All right. And that can be where we
end it for the night. Unless there's anything Mushi wanted to say or do at this point in time.
Is there actually a shield and an axe on the wall?
There is indeed.
Okay.
Oh dear, this is going to end bad.
No, it's not.
I can't think of anything off the top of my head, but maybe by next week I'll have something thought out.
Fair enough.
Do I get a gist of how the quantity of items in this satchel?
So as you kind of take your mug and go to your little, I'm guessing a corner, you use your dwarven intuition to kind of take count.
I was a merchant.
Of what you have before you.
Mm-hmm. I can appraise things. I'm good at it. Kind of.
And that is roughly what you believe the contents to be.
Alright. I see the axes and the shield on the wall. Do those look to be of battle readiness? Or are they...
As opposed to just props?
Props, yes.
Well, we can start off next
week rolling... Okay, I better write this down.
So ready.
I better write this down. Alright. Shit...
All right, so starting off with Cognar.
Oh, God.
What was his highlight for this session? Does he hope to accomplish next session?
My highlight is being alive. yeah, being alive and seeing Barrow again, that was great. Definitely.
And what does he hope to accomplish next session?
Oh, he's totally going to try to get that shield and those axes. And then he wants some revenge, and he wants his shit back. So that's what he's looking forward to. He's very fond of his hammer, so he wants that back.
All right, and Rebender.
I don't know if he's back or not.
Okay, Mushi.
Okay. My highlight was going to that charred area, the golden fields.
Golden fields.
Fields. I almost had it. I was a letter off. I liked that area. It was informational slightly, and it was extremely unexpected. So I really enjoyed that. But I really hope to accomplish is go to the Scarlet Moon Hall next session. We're going to do this, guys. I just feel it, you know, it's going to happen. Hopefully. And I hope it's not past 10 day and my guy is gone. I don't remember his name anymore.
Uh-oh.
God, that's bad. I better go back to my notes.
And Dangle, character highlight for this session. What does he hope to accomplish next session?
With everything that went on, character highlight was, as creepy as it was, leading a little girl into an abandoned house. Hoping that were to spring a trap, it would be her. That was totally his.
Terrible.
He's a goblin.
Man.
It's self-preservation.
Droop would be ashamed.
He would, but Droop's not here now. and next session is relaying the information and overall trying to be of help to the party. That's his thing next session.
Just not little girls.
She's not part of the party.
This is true.
That's it.
Right. And Leith.
Her highlight was bread.
She discovered gluten.
She's experiencing all sorts of crazy things she never thought she would see, like someone raising from the dead.
Oh, she learned how to eat. I guess that was. Sales. I guess that could have been Cogner's highlight. I mean, coming back to life was great.
You know, she's experiencing a lot, and I'm trying to get into playing her more as who she is. So I'm working on that. We'll see how that goes. I'm trying not to get her and my other character confused because for some reason I was dumb enough to make them a lot alike. So, I'm working on it. But I think what she's hoping to accomplish is not getting eaten by a bat. And I don't know, seeing what other crazy schemes this group comes up with. Because she seems to be enjoying herself, from watching people rise from the dead to fighting water to, you know, she's experiencing life in ways she never imagined possible recently. So.
Great.
Hopefully that'll be good.
So, Ben, what was Grabender's highlight for this session, and what does Grabender hope to accomplish next session?
Grabender's highlight was definitely getting Cognar back.
Yay, buddies!
He was getting sick and tired of losing, you know, friends and companions. And what does he hope to accomplish? Basically, he's doing his best not to be driven by the desire for revenge, and he's trying to just be helpful to those who he's traveling with. So he wants to, like, especially now that Mushi's kind of opening up to him, he really wants to figure out what's going on with her and try to help her out.
Poor little Mushi, the emo child.
That's deep.
Alright, and for Ryleth.
Ryleth is... he's happy he's found some people who seem to know what the hell is going on. And that he can...
what are you trying to say about Dangle and Lee?
I think he said it.
Dangle don't know shit.
Leith really doesn't either, and I literally just said that like 2 minutes ago, so I can't go back on my words.
She doesn't.
And generally, he's looking forward to laying the smackdown on some evildoers. He was very pleased that he's been able to at least get rid of one small band of slavers, but this sort of larger problem seems to be cropping up in the area. Certainly piqued his interest.
So, real quick on that point, you do know that there were others at Riverguard Keep. You guys did manage to stop, like, this ship in particular, but you know that there were others kind of working out of the keep. Okay.
Yeah, we're not done with them, but
no.
He's happy that we've at least taken out one crew of them, more or less. Okay.
Cool beans, guys. Well, excellent session tonight.
We missed our fourth.
Yeah, I'm going to have to give him a hard time next time I talk to him.
Yeah. Give him, like, a major hard time, because we don't open up to people, and he let us down.
And it's hard. Tell him it's, like, hard to talk to ourselves, because... Seriously.
Yes. I do have to say, just completely my opinion here. I do kind of think that, like, trying to run long term with everybody playing two characters could be a little complicated.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yep.
So if we can actually get a fourth and maybe even a fifth, then we might have to look towards, like, splitting off and doing maybe, like, alternating weeks or something.
They can go back to their slavers, and maybe we'll run into them again one day.
The slavers.
Hopefully, we'll have to.
You can just sell them into slavery. Be like, hey, you freed us. How much can we get for these guys?
Yeah, we can do it.
No, I definitely...
But at the same time, it's like, I don't want to not play Ryleth. I like him.
But... No, I definitely think that we could take a
break from this campaign and do a, you know, like a separate campaign, quotation marks, because you can't see him because I'm not in the camera.
Right.
Yeah, I agree. Once we get a fourth, then we can drop these guys off and they can do their own kind of, like, free the slaves kind of thing.
Maybe.
If we get a fourth person, it's going to be really hard for us to maintain seven characters.
No, I completely agree with that. I don't want to overload the DM with campaigns.
Well, as far as, like, campaigns go, like, if you guys want to do, like, an alternating week thing, one of the shift outs could be, like, them, the three of them going for Riverguard Keep or something like that, while the others head for Sacred, or what is it, Scarlet Moon Hall or something like that.
Oh.
Yeah.
It's like one of the weeks where they split up, and while they're still working for their goal, they're also helping the main party.
Right.
That could be cool. Okay.
So they just get a split
into part of that. Oh, shit. Yeah.
Right.
No, I like it. But that's if we get, if our fourth comes in.
Yeah.
And they stay in.
So just to give you guys a little bit of information on him. So he works where I work, but he works on the shift schedule. So basically his schedule is, it's complicated.
Mm.
He works 12-hour shifts.
Ooh.
And, well, they rotate. So like out of every 4 weeks, 2 weeks he's off on the weekend, and he should be able to make the night no problem. 2 weeks he's working that weekend, or on the weekend, but when he's working days on the weekend, he should be able to get home and just be here a little late.
Hmm.
When he's working nights on the weekend, he's just not going to be able to make it.
All
right. Cool. So basically, one week a month, he can't make it.
So those are the days we can use our alternate group.
Mm-hmm. That'd be a perfect time for it.
Perfect.
All right, make it so. Sorry.
You got this, DM. You
John
got
Luke
this.
Picard in there. Make it show.
So Zen, what was your highlight of the
evening?
Yeah.
What can we do to please your oral senses?
So my highlight of this session, my character highlight for this session was the voice I wound up with for Marcus, as it started somewhere and then just slowly drifted more towards Black Powder Merchant as it was going on.
I wanted like, Dangle, you know, to be Black Powder Merchant, but I couldn't quite get the voice.
And good old Victor. And what do you hope to accomplish next week other than killing us all?
As far as next week, I'm interested to see really what direction you guys go. Because, like, there's an ox waiting for you in Red Larch, but that's by land, meaning you leave the ship behind. There's the ship in the completely opposite direction if you want to attempt to repair that. There's Summit Hall, where the... Sorry, I'll bring you guys back to the map.
While he ponders over everything.
There's Summit Hall, where you were told some knights are. And there is Westbridge, further up north, where you were told some of the stone-faced guys were. And then, in the middle of all of that, there is the Scarlet Moon Hall, the Feathergale Spire, the Monastery, and the Keep.
Wow.
This is what we want.
I get
focus
it. You
on
want the world to end.
You know what she wants.
That's, I want answers. I don't want it to end. I want answers.
So basically, we're really in the wrong part of the map to be doing anything.
Well, you know, we might come here by... By design.
Yes.
Ish. I will say, Golden Fields was written in as basically a thing like, if you go down that way, here's a thing. I took some liberties with that.
Because we ain't got for shit. Reasons.
But, you know, there was the party of seven individuals that the party passed when they were heading up for the Feathergale Spire for the first time. And those individuals, six of them were armored with goggles, and one of them had robes and a short beard.
Did we actually pass those guys?
Headed in a particular direction.
Oh my god.
They had a thing for tieflings.
Of course they did. They started a giant freaking field fire.
That's not for tieflings, that's just their own.
How long ago was that?
That's not a tiefling thing. That's not tieflings, that was like...
Wow. I mean, that was like 3 months ago, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was. That was like six, eight.
And in game, I can't say how long ago it was because then you guys will know how long you were underground.
Right. No, I get that. I mean,
that was like 12 sessions ago, right?
Did we like stop and talk to them in the path?
Yes. Yep. Yes, we did. Remember? Because they said that they never saw tiefling before.
Fight.
Right.
And we all, like, we got way out of the way, and then they're like, oh, you're a tiefling. I've never seen a tiefling before.
He's the one who wanted to feel your voice.
Do you actually have a tail? God. And you're like, we need to leave this motherfucker right now. He's creepy.
Right.
He was the creepy old man who was trying to hit on you.
And then he was down here, and that place
that makes me
fire. Want to
kill anybody that we come on the road. And meat.
Well, there was that goat farmer who seemed pretty nefarious.
He had a giant goat.
Funny story. So, Leith is a far wanderer, and she is a Goliath. And Goliaths, they choose their nicknames, you know?
Uh-huh.
And, like, I just go to that random create name thing, and, like, half of them, the nickname was Goat Herder. And I wanted to pick it so bad just for that. I'd be like, I'm related
Wait,
to this.
Is Leith the giant goat? We didn't get Leith yet, right?
Could be.
Ooh. Ooh. It could happen.
So she wasn't actually in the slave trade. She was just a goat.
She was enslaved.
She was a goat. She was a goat sailor.
A goat tree.
One day just sort of wandered up.
Oh, Lord.
I mean, maybe she was a goat once, so it could happen.
Sure. Were you a goat or were you a sheep? I'm pretty sure you were a sheep.
I don't know. I didn't read it. You guys just told me. I don't remember.
Well, you said it was a sheep.
I was a sheep with horns. I was a ram. Can I be a ram?
No.
Not a ram.
Because you got polymorphed, and polymorph is the sheep.
That is written, guys. It can't be a goat. It can't be a ram. It has to be a sheep.
That's right.
It says a sheep.
There is no modifying the rules whatsoever.
Whatsoever.
None.
Most of the rules.
I apologize.
All
right,
guys.
Yep. Have a wonderful night.
Night, everybody.
Bye. Good night.